Okay, so we're going on to the parable of the seed there in Mark chapter 4, verses 26 through 29, as we continue on the adventure of discovering the doctrine of Jesus through the parables that he told. And his parables just make it so simple for us to grasp and understand the application of these stories. So the parable of the seed, starting at verse 26, and he was saying, the kingdom of God is like a man who casts seed upon the soil. And take note, this is from Mark chapter 4, starting at verse 26. Do you remember, we covered this a while back, several weeks ago, but do you remember the parable in Mark chapter 4, verse 13? That is the parable where the sower is sowing the seed on different kinds of hearts, different kinds of ground. The stony ground, the shallow ground, and so forth. And so if you remember that parable from several weeks ago, this is the same chapter in Mark. It's just further on down in the chapter. And I really believe that when he says the sower sows the word of God is the seed. I think as Jesus rolls into this parable in verse 26, I think he's following that same theme. And I think it's very safe for us to follow that same theme where he says the kingdom of God is like a man who casts seed upon the soil. So borrowing from verses 13 and 14 earlier in the chapter, the seed we understand to be the word of God. The kingdom of God is like a man who casts seed or sows the word of God upon the soil. Verse 27, and he goes to bed at night and gets up by day, and the seed sprouts and grows, how he himself, what, does not know. And that is a promise to you and me as Christians, because as we receive the Word of God and meditate on the Word of God and pray the Word of God, and as the Word of God abides in our heart, the Word of God is doing marvelous things in you that you don't even comprehend right now. And you need to see that your spiritual growth and your righteousness comes from the Word of God. It doesn't come from any efforts of our own. We simply surrender and obey to the work of God within. And as we surrender and obey to the Word of God growing in our heart, because it's alive, it's powerful, it grows within us, as we surrender to the Word of God in all areas of our life, it is growing and sprouting and producing the character of God in us in ways that we don't even know. And this is how we want to grow spiritually. We've talked a lot lately about the fact that spiritual growth does not come from self-discipline. Self-discipline does not equal spiritual growth. In fact, the two are opposites. And the more you try to improve yourself through self-discipline, the more you are short-circuiting the work of the Holy Spirit, and the more He can't work. So it really becomes a thing where we have faith in God, and we wait for the gift of righteousness, and we wait for Him to fix and correct all of these things in our heart. And we do so by saturating ourselves with the Word of God through study, through meditation. We want to get that word deep into our heart. We want to be meditating on the word of God day and night. And there is a righteousness that is transferred and worked in us that we could never produce on our own, no matter how strong our self-discipline is. So we live completely opposite of the world system. We don't believe in willpower. We don't believe in self-discipline or self-righteousness by self-discipline. We believe in surrender to the Word of God and allowing the Word of God to have His way in us. That is the root and the foundation of our righteousness. He goes on and he says, you know, this seed begins to grow. The farmer doesn't know how it's growing, but the soil produces crops by itself. And first you see a blade, and then you see the head, and then you see the mature grain in the head. And what he's saying by that in verse 28 is the fact that that seed contains everything that's needed to produce that plant or that tree or the fruit of the vine, the fruit of what's going to come. And so it involves everything. And so when you receive the Word of God as that seed in your heart, that seed can grow into the fullness of God living within. Just like the seed has the life and the power to produce everything in the lifespan of that plant, so does the Word of God as a seed has the power and life to produce in you everything that pertains to godliness. It's awesome. But when the crop permits, he immediately puts in the sickle because the harvest has come. All right, so let's talk about this. What lessons? Three lessons from this parable for tonight. The seed contains in itself the life and power to germinate, propagate, and reproduce. And as you receive the Word of God by faith into your heart, it will reproduce the full character of God in you. That's what it's designed to do. And everything from the little blade to the stem to the mature fruit, that's what that seed will produce in you. It's a growth process. And it takes time. In fact, it takes a lifetime. It's nothing, you know, we can't change ourselves in a moment. We all wish we could. But boy, man, some of our attitudes and some of our motives and some of that selfishness and pride, they run awful deep, don't they? And it takes a long time for the Lord and for the Holy Spirit and the Word of God to get down and dig it out by the root. But he says here in 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 23, "For you have been born again, not of seed which is perishable, but of seed which is what? Imperishable. That is, through the living and the enduring Word of God." So the Word of God is the seed. And it is imperishable. It's an eternal seed. And it contains within itself all of the life and all of the power to reproduce Jesus Christ in you. Nothing else can do it but the Word of God. And so we surrender to the work of the Word in our heart. And we don't fall back onto a self-righteousness or a religious self-discipline. We simply have faith in the Word of God and we begin to read it and devour it. 1 John chapter 3, verse 9, "No one who is born of God practices sin because his seed abides in him, and he cannot sin because he's born of God." Nobody who has this seed of the Word of God in their heart through the new birth, you can't continue in sin. Oh, you may have lapses here and there throughout your life. You may backslide once or twice in your life, but you're miserable. And even when you sin, not a sin of rebellion, but you sin in a moment of weakness, your heart hurts and your conscience grieves and you feel terrible for what you did, you just can't keep doing it. Why? Because the seed is in you. And the seed will keep calling you back to God. No one who is born of God practices sin. It's not saying that we don't sin from time to time, because unfortunately we do. But you can't live a lifestyle of sin. You can't stay in a lifestyle of sin. You can't keep practicing sin over and over again. It grieves your heart. It makes you miserable. Psalm says it dries up your bones. The guilt hangs so heavy on you. And that's because of the seed, the Word of God, abiding in you. You cannot sin because you are born of God. That seed causes that new birth, to where the resurrection life of Jesus Christ causes you to be born again into a new creature. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16. "All Scripture is given by inspiration of God." We know that that means the very breath of God breathed out these words. I've shared with you before, but Charles Spurgeon has a great quote where he says, "Read as many good books as you can." And he's talking about good Christian books. "Read as many good books as you can, but live in the Bible." No matter how good that favorite book or that favorite author is, nothing can replace the Word of God. The Word of God is the very breath of God. The Word of God is inspired by God. The Word of God is the life of God. It's the wisdom of God. It's the seed, when planted in your heart, will reproduce in you Jesus Christ. All Scripture is given by inspiration of God. It's profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness. Don't try to do self-righteousness on your own and your own self-discipline. Let the Word of God begin to instruct you how to be righteous, that the man of God may be perfect, and look at the next two words, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. Really, all you need is the Bible. The Word of God will thoroughly furnish you for every good work. The Word of God is the seed which will reproduce after its kind, and it will birth in you the life and the power of God. That is what builds the character of Christ in you. So the seed, the Word, contains all of the life and power of God to reproduce God living within. James chapter 1, verse 18, in the exercise of His will, He brought us forth, meaning He gave birth to us by the Word of truth, so that we would be a kind of first fruits among His creatures. First fruits there is talking about the burnt offering, the offerings and sacrifices of old. And it's talking about the fact that when we become born again, we become those living sacrifices that demonstrate His will and His purpose, that are surrendered to do what He wants us to do. So we see that we're born again in life and in power by the seed of the Word of God. And that seed is growing in you, and it's growing in me, and it's producing Christ-likeness in us. It's something supernatural that, you know, you can't even describe the process. But if you will hide the Word of God in your heart, the Word of God goes to work. Number two, we must guard the seed. The farmer must guard the seed, but the farmer has no power to make the seed grow. The power is in the Word, and it reproduces in and of itself. But we do have to guard the seed. Remember Proverbs chapter 4, verse 20. My son, give attention to my words. Incline your ear to my sayings. Do not let them depart from your sight. Keep them in the midst of your heart. Let me ask you, have you been doing lately? Have you kept the Word of God in your sight at all times? Have you kept them in the midst of your heart? And like we've said before, write it on an index card, put Bibles and a Bible app on your phone. Do whatever you have to do to, as you're at work during the day, take breaks here and there and take out the Bible and keep it in your sight. Keep it in the midst of your heart. It's so much better than the junk, the world. You'd be so better off without all of the news and current events on TV and all the entertainment. You'd be so better off just to keep saturating your heart with the Word of God over and over again, because that's where life is. And you'd see how vain and empty everything on this earth is if you started to taste more of the Word of God. In verse 22, he says, if you'll keep them, if you'll keep the Word in the midst of your heart, they are life to those who find them. You know, when you spend time away from the Word of God, you can feel your spirit and your heart shriveling up and dying, can't you? When you spend time away from the Word of God, you can feel hope draining out of your soul. You can feel the depression and the sorrow and the fears coming on. But if you will spend time in the Word of God, His Word is life to those who find them. Your joy will be rejuvenated. It's health to your body. Watch over your heart with all diligence, for from it flows the springs of life. One of the most important things you will do every day is enjoy God. Get in His presence and just simply eat from His table, drink from His wells of life. Guard your heart by enjoying God. And as you enjoy Him, as you really just seek Him in His Word, you'll find yourself revived and renewed. That's your number one priority. And be willing to turn off or cut off anything that distracts you. away from the Word of God. Watch over your heart with all diligence, for from it flows the spring of life. And if you pollute that spring with all of the distractions and news and wisdom of this world, you're going to die. You're going to poison that well inside of you. So don't let that happen. The things that we guard against. Remember, again, this is going back up in Mark 4, several verses, into this other parable. The things that we guard our heart from, we guard our heart from Satan coming immediately to steal the word. We guard our heart from the rocky places, you know, and when trials and persecution comes, we get offended and we fall away and we say, well, why didn't God save me? Why didn't God do something about this? Why isn't God answering my prayers? Why isn't God taking this problem away? That's what verse 17 there. So you have to guard your heart against the offense of the afflictions and the persecutions. And quite frankly, you need to just shut up and surrender and let God have His way in your life. And if I'm going through a trial, then God must know that I need this trial. Don't be offended by it. Surrender to the will and the plan of God in your life. You have to guard your heart against that offense, but then you also have to guard your heart against the thorns. What are the thorns? The worries of this world? There's a whole bunch of worries, man. If you go down that path of worry, there is no end, and that path just goes downhill, deeper and deeper, darker and darker. Don't go down there. The deceitfulness of riches. You know, the vanity of thinking the more I get, the more I have, the happier I'll be, the more secure I'll be. No, those riches can take wings and fly away in a moment. It's not worth it. Settle your heart on the Word of God. Let the Word of God be the riches that you pursue. The desires for other things enter in. The desire for pleasure or entertainment or amusements. And all of those things start to creep in, and the word becomes choked, and the life starts to die. How disastrous. So that's how we guard our life. That's where we guard our life from. And then Psalms chapter 1, verse 1, this is where we want to get in our life and in our daily practice. How blessed is the man who does not walk in the counsel of the wicked, nor stand in the path of sinners, nor sit in the seat of scoffers. You should find yourself at work or when you're around other believers in whatever setting, you should find yourself staying quiet more and more. I can't enter into this conversation. Christians don't do this. Christians don't talk like this. And then you can speak up in the appropriate time with the Word of God and with words of encouragement and with good, wholesome words. But we don't walk in that counsel. We don't participate in those conversations. We don't stand in the path of sinners. There's a separation between us and them. And it's not a physical separation because we are bumping elbows with them every day in the world. But there sure is a spiritual separation, and it's a separation of light and darkness. That's how drastic the contrast is. We're different. We meditate on the Word of God. We don't meditate on all the filth of the world system. Why? Because verse 2, our delight is in the law of the Lord, and in His law we meditate how often? Day and night. Day and night. Day and night. You need to make a practice of as soon as you wake up in the morning, you open your Bible, even if it's just for a few moments. Make a practice before you lay your head down on the pillow at night, open the Bible. Read a psalm, read Proverbs, whatever you're reading. Throughout the day, keep putting the Word of God in front of your eyes and in your heart. You know, that's what the old phylacteries were about. If you remember, the Jews had phylacteries, and the phylactery would either sit right here on the forehead or sit on the wrist or the back of the hand. And in it, it would be a little leather-like box, and it would contain scriptures. And it was, the phylactery sitting right on your forehead, I mean, you saw it. It was right there in your peripheral vision wherever you looked and whatever you were doing. and on the back of the hands, whatever you were busy doing, whatever work or toil or labor you were involved in, you saw it because it was right there in front of you, just reminding you of the scriptures that were inside of that leather pouch. And so that's how they kind of fulfilled God's word and God's law in that way. Do whatever it takes, man, to make sure that you're meditating day and night on the word of God. Nothing else can replace it. If you do, it says he will be like a tree firmly planted by streams of water. Firmly planted by streams of water. I'm sure you've all had the occasion to walk by a lake or a pond or a river or a stream. And everything else could be dead, brown, with drought. But what about the plants growing along the edge of the stream? We know what that's like. It has a constant supply of water and nutrients and life. And it yields its fruit in its season. You're going to have to be consistent with this. It doesn't happen overnight. You know, that pride that you have goes a lot deeper than you think it does. That bad temper that you have, it probably goes in there with some gnarly twists and turns around insecurities and around other things, that past experiences and wounds in your heart, and those things play and trigger off of one another. And God, it's going to take time for God to get down to the root of all of that and sort it out and heal your heart. So it's going to come in seasons. It's not going to happen overnight. You're going to have to be patient in sowing the seed of the Word of God day and night, month after month, year after year into your heart. It yields its fruit in its season, and its leaf does not wither. And whatever you do will prosper because you are being propelled now by the life of the Word of God. The wicked are not so. They don't have that stream of living water feeding them. They are like chaff, and they dry and they burn up. And the wind drives them away. Lastly, I want you to see the life and power inside of the seed takes us through all of the stages of spiritual growth to full maturity. You know, in times of failure, in times of success, in times of loss, in times of gain, in times of victory, in times of defeat, the Word of God is working in you through all of those seasons. That's why you can't quit. You can't give up. Keep sowing the Word of God into your heart. And here in Hebrews chapter 4, verse 9, he says, so there remains a Sabbath rest for the people of God. Now, what is the Sabbath rest? The Sabbath rest is the seventh day. God did work the 6 days, and on the seventh day, God did no work. And the word of his creation just kept all of the universe in motion. And so that Sabbath rest is talking about the seventh day rest that God entered into. For the one who has entered his rest, the one who enters God's rest, this Sabbath rest, the one who enters the rest of the word of God, the rest that comes from the word of God, has himself also rested from what? His works. As God did from his. So it's talking about the Word of God taking over your spiritual life. And you're not striving and straining in your own self-discipline and willpower now. You're not trying to make changes happen, but you are submitted and surrendered to the change that the Word of God is bringing. And so you can rest from your works. It's not up to you anymore. It's up to the Word of God. If you continue to sow it into your heart day and night, you can rest from your works of self-effort and striving and self-righteousness. Let the Word do its job. Therefore, let us be diligent to enter that rest so that no one will fall. If you're trying to be a Christian through your self-efforts and self-discipline, you're going to fall every time. Your flesh can't keep up with the righteousness of God. Let us be diligent to enter that rest so that no one will fall through following the same example of disobedience of the Israelites, of thinking they knew better and they could do it better. Verse 12, for the word of God is living and active and sharper than any two-edged sword. Read a lot of good books, but live in the Bible. Because no matter how good that book or author is, those words that are written are not alive and powerful like the Word of God is. The Word of God is the breath of God. The Word of God is the heart of God. The Word of God is the passion of God. It's the power of God. And watch this. It's living. It's active. If you will be consistent in sowing the Word of God into your heart day and night, the Word is actively working in you in every season of your life, in every circumstance. It never stops. That Word just keeps working. It's active. And it's sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing as far as the division of soul and spirit. And it will cut through your motives. It will cut through your attitudes. It will cut through your wounds and past hurts. It will cut through the insecurities. And God knows how to sift and work through all of that in ways that you would never be able to figure out. Of both joints and marrow, it's able to judge the thoughts and the intentions of the heart. Let me encourage you tonight. You have problems you don't even know about yet. It takes time for the Word of God to sift through your hearts, your thoughts, your intentions. And He will reveal to you what's going on the inside and what's been wrong for so many years. And the good news is He fixes it by the power of His Word. Let the Word of God work in your heart. He does it in the most ingenious, mysterious, wonderful way if you will give the Word of God the place in your heart that it's supposed to have. There is no creature hidden from His sight, but all things are open and laid bare to the eyes of Him with whom we have to do. Let's go through this last verse, Isaiah chapter 55, starting at verse 10. We'll end with this. For as the rain and the snow come down from heaven and do not return there without watering the earth and making it bare and sprout and furnishing seed to the sower and bread to the eater. Look at verse 11. So will my word be which goes forth from my mouth. It will not return to me empty. When you take the Bible and you sow the Word of God into your heart day and night, you have results that are guaranteed by God. It will not return to Him empty. Shelley, I love what you do with Facebook and the fact that you have constant scripture up there. If you want to use Facebook for anything, that's the best thing to use it for. I'm talking about the Westgate Chapel Facebook page that she manages. It will not return to me empty without accomplishing what I desire and without succeeding in the matter for which I sent it. Guaranteed success. You can't get guaranteed success anywhere else in the world. But with the Word of God, you've got guaranteed success if you'll give it the place in your heart that it's supposed to have. And as the Word begins to work, then you will go out with joy and be led forth with peace. And the mountains and the hills will break forth into shouts of joy before you. And all the trees of the field will clap their hands, rejoicing with you at the presence of God. Father, we thank You for Your Word to us tonight. We thank You for this parable. Lord, we are so thankful that Jesus gives us His doctrine in the form of these stories. Thank You for making it simple and clear. Father, we ask that You would teach us how to meditate on Your Word day and night. Father, it doesn't come right away. It takes practice. We have to learn how to do it. We have to learn how to manage our thoughts and manage our time and manage our schedule and manage all the deadlines. And we have to learn this. It's an acquired skill. It doesn't come naturally. So we ask for help from Your Holy Spirit. Teach us how to meditate day and night so that we can be like that tree that's planted by the waters. Father, as we go with us. I pray for Your peace and safety upon every house, upon every heart here. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.